As protests continue across the nation around the death of George Floyd and the issue of policing, black police officers are finding themselves in the middle, on an emotional tightrope. We caught up with Metro police officers about their life being black while wearing blue.
My son was 9 years old, and he said, "Mom, you can't take that job.
You don't look like a police officer." Like, what does a police officer look like?
Arnold Parker is a current officer with Metro. Regina Coward-Holman retired from the force after 27 years. Both took an oath to protect and serve, just like Adrian Hunt, who also wants to make a difference in his hometown.
Everybody has their calling. My calling is service.
But as black police officers, all three say there's a struggle.
No peace!
Especially as protests against police brutality erupt across the country.
I've had plenty of calls, you know, in the last past 2-3 months, where officers are saying, like, man, I just don't know how to feel because we're stuck in the middle.
The death of unarmed black Americans like Breonna Taylor, who was shot in her home, and George Floyd, who died in police custody, have prompted calls for change.
I had no words. That was by far the most reckless police act I've seen all my whole life.
Tension between police and the black community isn't new. From the first slave patrol groups in the 1700s to segregation and Jim Crow in the 1960s, violence and racism towards black Americans resulted in protests and uprising. Now, in the year 2020, law enforcement is under the microscope. For Coward-Holman, it's an ongoing discussion with her son. Hunt and Parker share experiences as black men who've been profiled.
I was probably 13, 14, coming out the Meadows Mall. I had shotguns to my face, me and a couple buddies. But nobody ever said, okay, you know what? You know, we're sorry about that. It was a mix-up.
When I take this uniform off, I'm just a black man. So what is the next person, how are they looking at me?
Hunt says he's been questioned while in uniform.
And I had people telling me, you know, what you over there for? You need to be over here with us, you know. And it never crossed my mind that where I'm supposed to be, I know where I'm supposed to be.
But they are where they're supposed to be.
You got kids that... say that, hey, you know what, like, I never want to be a police officer. To my kids that used to, you know, that gangbang, currently gangbang, to where now they actually think about being a police officer.
Officers agree discussions about racial biases with coworkers can promote change on the job and in society. Hunt says the Black Police Officers Association helps bridge the gap, but black officers say there has to be intentional effort from everyone.
Always push and push into, you know, to get more people who look like me to join the department.
We have to continue to have the conversations about black lives, about systemic racism, about changes in the police department, being transparent, being accountable.
And joining us are Craig Knight, the general manager of Power 88.1 radio station, and Kennedy Cobbin Richardson, executive director at Nevada Partners. Now, the Black Officers Association, they raised some interesting points. Kennedy, what are your thoughts about having more black officers on the police department?
Certainly, it is important to bring more black officers into the force for the simple reason that the force should look like the community that it serves. And with that being said, a lot of times they are not welcome as well into the force, so they do have a really high road to climb. And then it's also important that they're comfortable in the communities that they serve as well. So you can't, as Craig said, you can't go in and be afraid of that community that you are supposed to protect. And I have two little girls who are really afraid and fearful of just seeing a cop. And I hurt for them because I believe the youth, really, if you want to grow up to be something, you'll never be a cop because you don't, you're afraid of who they are and how they treat you.
Well, thank you for sharing that. Craig, the officers also talked about how they've been profiled in their lives. Can you address that? You know, what is that mental impact on those officers?
Yeah, it's almost a double jeopardy. It's like, you know, being a police officer in uniform, that uniform represents some bad experiences. So it's almost like a lot of the officers are painted with a broad brush, but just like black people in the community are painted with a broad brush. There's like prejudices that go both ways on that. But with the black officer, like I said, it's a double jeopardy because when they take the uniform off, they're still black. And then they got to deal with the, you know, systemic racism, and they have to deal with the prejudices of not even people not even knowing they're officer. So and then within the department itself, you know, the question is, how do they feel? That's got to be kind of uncomfortable, especially when things like this happen with the latest, you know, being with Jacob Blake. There has to be some kind of uncomfortable. They're like right in the middle. And I think that, it's, once again, it just comes down to we have to remove the racism and the prejudices and look at people for who they are and look at their heart, you know? Yeah,
definitely impacting everybody. Brian?
Bianca, thank you. Facing day-to-day discrimination. Up next, the I-Team's Vanessa Murphy tells us about one case of discrimination at a local country club. And our panel is back talking about facing discrimination in day-to-day life. Stay with us.